And how bad is my cooking that you're that excited about glue? I'm both concerned and insulted at this point. No, I do love my kids. I do. I don't like them sometimes. I do love them. And as parents, we do anything for our kids, don't we? And every year, now we haven't been to it the last couple of years because of COVID, but every year there's a father-daughter princess ball. And my girls absolutely love bowling. So every year I spend a gajillion dollars on princess dresses, and I put on my suit that I got at Goodwill, and we go to the princess ball. And it's a lot of fun for them. There's a lot of activities. There's crafts and there's games and there's, you know, of course there's a big dance floor in the gym. And it's a lot of fun. And it's funny though, because when you walk into the dance floor, it's the same scenario every year. You walk in and it's all the dads around the dance floor watching while the girls are on the dance floor dancing their little hearts out. So the last time we went, it was no different. We walked in, and all the dads are standing around the dance floor holding all the crap that they've made that night. And all the girls are on the dance floor just getting down. And then there's me, right in the middle of them all, doing my absolute best Michael Jackson moves to the Frozen song. Now, I don't think that's what Elsa meant when she said, "Let it go." But I gave it my best because that ice queen knows how to party. A lot of people ask me, why comedy? Why, especially why now? Why start comedy right now? And I did my first stand-up set in a comedy club in front of an audience at 38 years old. But that wasn't actually my first interaction with stand-up comedy. When I was a teenager, I actually told my first joke in front of a crowd at a stand-up show. And I was with my church youth group. I was 17. We were at an international youth convention with the church youth group, and it was a week-long convention, and every evening there was different activities that you could do. And one evening, and I've always loved stand-up comedy. It's just something about it. I've always gravitated towards it. And one evening, they were having a comic come, and you know, everybody that I was there with, man, we got to go see this guy. I've never heard of him, but we got to go see him. So, okay, yeah, we all go. We go early. I sit right down up in front. We all, you know, line the front row. I'm sitting right in the middle, right in front of him, and I'm hoping so bad. Man, I hope this guy calls on me, or even if he makes a joke about me, I just want to be part of the show. Just I hope somehow I'm a part of this show. And the comic gets close to start time for the show. The comic comes in, and he walks in and walks right up to me. And I just was frozen. I didn't expect that. Walks right up to me. "Hey, how you doing? What's your name?" "Justin." He tells me, he says, "Hey, Justin, I need your help." He said, I need you to help me with this show tonight. Okay. He hands me a button. It's attached to a cord, goes into a sound system. He says, "If I tell a joke and nobody's laughing, which tends to happen, even to the best comics," he says, "if I tell a joke and nobody's laughing, I want you to hit that button, and it's going to be a drum roll." He says, "Then everybody will laugh, and we'll move on." Now, the fact that, number one, I don't remember who this comic was, and he had to have a backup plan. Like, he knew he had jokes coming that weren't going to get laughs. it speaks volumes to how good he was. But he comes out on stage, and he's a middle-aged, overweight guy. I know I got a lot of room to talk, but he's a middle-aged, overweight guy. He comes out on stage, and right away, his first joke he leads off with, he says, "You know, I used to drink a lot of Diet Coke." I'm so proud of myself. The place is going wild. The comic's giving me the death stare. The whole place is just, it's a big ruckus. He walks up to me and he says, "Give me the button." And you would think that I'd be upset about how I lost my opportunity. No. Because I had the whole place laughing and I didn't even say a word. So he takes the button and he hands it to somebody else and goes on with his show. And he comes up to me afterwards and he says, "You know, comics don't really like it when you take over, when somebody else takes over their crowd." He said, "No, I'm not mad at you because you're a teenager, you didn't know." He said, "What I am mad about is I've never seen anybody take a crowd in the first 5 seconds of a show without even saying anything." So that was actually my first interaction with comedy. A lot of people, you know, they ask me now, why are you getting serious about it? Why are you, you know, why is this something you're doing more of? Is it you not have enough on your plate? You really need a hobby that bad? Are you having a midlife crisis? And the answer to all those is yes, but that's not why I'm doing it. It's actually very simple. To answer that, let me back up a little bit and tell you about me, okay? I grew up going to church 3 times a week, twice on Sunday and every Wednesday night. And I learned all the Bible stories. I knew all the hymns. I remembered all the memory verses. And I got really good at going to church. Had an understanding that there was a set of rules, and if I followed those rules, did everything that I was supposed to at church, that was going to get me into heaven. I, 5 days after my 18th birthday, I graduated high school, and 2 weeks after that, I was on my way to basic training for the Army. Not long after that, 9/11 happened. And a little while after that, I found myself in Balad, Iraq. It was in 2003. My father had just passed away a month prior to that. And that was absolutely devastating for me. He was my best friend. So I'm sitting in Iraq. I'm 20 years old. I'm scared and I'm depressed. By the grace of God and some buddies that have my back, I made it home safe and sound. When I got home, I wasn't happy about it. Why did I get to come home? What was it about me that I deserved to come home, but those guys didn't? I struggled with being home so much that I did the only thing I knew at that point in time, what I thought would help. And I turned to alcohol. To the point that I was drinking all day, every day, as a very young man, making bad decisions. And I lost everything. I lost jobs. I lost relationships. I lost friends. I lost my driver's license. Spent time in county jail. So when I say I lost everything, I mean I lost everything. And I was angry because I did everything that I was supposed to do. I was a good kid growing up. I never got in trouble in high school. I never did anything to get in trouble in high school. I joined the military. Serve my country. I went overseas and I fought and I fought and I fought and I came home. I thought that if I did everything I was supposed to do, that life would be good. I held up my end of the bargain. So why was I losing everything? I had to sit and listen to people saying, well, he's not who he used to be. I wish you could have known him before he went to Iraq. I got several buddies in here that have been there. And I'm sure you guys have all heard the same thing at some point in time. I didn't do anything wrong, so why was everybody leaving me? I felt abandoned. So one night, I'd had enough. I hit my knees, and in between sobs, I asked God, why are you punishing me? Why is everybody leaving me? Why are you leaving me? Why did you leave me? God, why did you leave me? Let me tell you something, folks. Not only did my family members not go anywhere, God never left. I walked away from him. I have a rule with my kids when it comes to sports or activities that they do, where they can do anything they want. If there's an activity they want to do or a sport they want to play, absolutely, give it a shot. And I'll go in 100% with you. I'll support you, but you're going to finish the season. You're not going to quit. You don't have to do it again the next year if you don't want to. You don't ever have to do it again, but you're going to finish that season. Now, I'm sure a lot of you are thinking, well, I'm teaching them a lesson about perseverance or about honoring their commitments or not quitting. No. You have any idea how expensive that crap is? My kids last year they played baseball, all three of them. I had to buy the gloves, I had to buy the expensive bats, I had to buy the cool bags to carry it on, I had to buy the name brand cleats, the uniform. And then there's the fees just to even play. If I'm gonna shell out that much money, you ain't quitting. You're going to play. And if you don't ever want to play again, I'm going to sell you crap. But anytime my kids want to do something like that, any kind of activity that's going to help them along in their life and going to teach them life lessons that they can use later on, I'm in 100% because that's an investment for me. And when you invest that much money into it, you don't walk away. You're going to finish that season. My God invested in me so much that he gave his only son to come down here and die for me and for you and for you and for you. I was willing to go and take a bullet for people I didn't even know. Jesus came down to this earth and took so much more than that. When you invest that much into somebody, you don't walk away. God never walked away from me. It was me that was looking to the wrong places. Years later, I figured out that that price that was paid on that cross was the only thing that was going to get me into heaven. It wasn't the set of rules. It wasn't what I thought growing up. Now, don't get me wrong. Once I figured that out, I did have an honest conversation with God. And I said, will you please take me back? And I still have my struggles. I still have sin in my life that I'm trying to break free from every day. And that's okay. There's everybody has struggles. Everybody has sin. There's not one person on this earth that doesn't have sin. It's not a flip of a switch. It's a process. I'm always going to be evolving. I'm always going to be taking the next step. I'm always going to be under construction. So why come? Well, I'm glad you asked. As part of that construction, God takes things that at the time are bad, are devastating, and He switches it around, lets you use those things for good. He's allowing me to take all the heartache that I've felt in the past, all the wrong things that I've done, and still do, all the hurt that I've experienced, the loss, the devastation, the anger, the guilt,